correct.
Well, the mayor and I are supposed to go to Lake George here.
That's right. First week of June or second week of June. Or
that's the sixth. We can't
as long be here. As it's not a meeting.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The hour is 7 p.m., and as mayor, I hereby call to order the Laconia City Council meeting scheduled for April 25th. As always, we'll begin our meeting with a salute to the American flag. I'd ask you to please rise and join Councilor Henry Lippman in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. For the record, I will note that the minutes to tonight's meeting are being kept by City Clerk Mary Reynolds, and I would ask that she please call the roll.
Councilor
Gura. Here.
Councilor Bounds.
Here.
Councilor Lippman.
Present.
Councilor Bear.
Present.
Councilor Hamel.
Present.
Councilor Baldick.
Here.
Presiding Mayor Edwards.
Oh, I got to go with here tonight. Even things out. Okay, let the record show that all six city councilors are present tonight and a quorum is established for this meeting. And we'll also note for the record that the council is joined at the front table tonight by City Manager Scott Myers and by the City Finance Officer Donna Woodeman. First order of regular business is acceptance of minutes. In your packet tonight, you have the minutes for both the regular and non-public meeting held on April 11th. Meetings, I should say, held on April 11th. Those minutes were distributed to the council on April 15th. No corrections were received at the clerk's office. Are there any corrections or notations to be made at this point in time? If not, I will declare that without objection, that the minutes for the April 15th regular meeting and the April 15th non-public meeting are approved as submitted by the clerk. And we will move on to our consent and action calendar. We have four items tonight. The first is on page 12 of your packet. And this is a request from the Lakeport Community Association to raise funds on city property and waive vendor and site review fees. And what they're looking for here is to park cars on Motorcycle Week in the parking lot in and around the former Lakeport Fire Station during Motorcycle Week of this year. So a motion would be in order to approve that request per the same as has been in recent years.
So moved.
Councilor Hamel, seconded by Councilor Bear. Any discussion? All those who would approve the request from the Lakeport Community Association, please raise a hand. Yes. Any opposed?
I'm not going to vote because I'm the one asking for it.
Okay. We have five votes in the affirmative and Councilor Baldick abstains. Okay, thank you. Sure. Next up is a request from Laconia Main Street Farmers Market, and that is on page 17 of your packet. This is the last meeting, I think we approved the farmers market in the City Hall parking lot, which meets on Saturdays. This is the Thursday afternoon farmers market in the central parking lot between Main Street and Pleasant Street. And this is accompanied by a temporary traffic order, which is in your packet on page 18. The same as last year. It's a temporary traffic order that will take effect from June 16th to September 29th on Thursday afternoons. And we would also at the same time be honoring a request to waive vendor fees for that event. Okay. So a motion would be in order to approve temporary traffic order 2016-06 for Laconia Main Street Farmers Market and to waive associated vendor fees. Moved by Councilor Baldick, seconded by Councilor Bear. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. We have six votes in the affirmative, and that motion also carries. Next up is another temporary traffic order. It's on page 19 of your packet. This is relative to the annual 4th of July parade and festivities. The temporary traffic order is on page 20 of your packet. And a motion would be in order to approve temporary traffic order 2016-07 relative to July 4th parking and festivities as presented. Moved by Counselor Bolduc, seconded by Counselor Bear. Any discussion? All those in favor of that temporary traffic order, please raise a hand. I have 6 votes in the affirmative, and it is also approved. Lastly, we have a temporary traffic order relative to Laconia Motorcycle Week 2016. That is on page 21 of your packet, and the actual temporary traffic order is on 22, 23, and 24. I am advised that there are no changes to the traffic order for last year. And so a motion would be in order to approve temporary traffic order 2016-08 relative to Laconia Motorcycle Week 2016 as presented. I'm sorry.
Just for clarification,
there was one small change, my mistake, and that was regarding those 3 parking spaces that we agreed to rent to AMSOIL last week. So that's
going to ask about that.
That's the only change. Sorry, I got past me. So may I have a motion to approve traffic resolution 2016-08? Moved by Councilor Doyle, seconded by Councilor Bear. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. I have 6 votes in the affirmative, and that resolution is adopted. And that is the end of consent and action for tonight. We are on to citizen comments for matters not on the agenda. This would be the appropriate time for anyone who is with us tonight in the audience who wishes to address the council on any matter that is not on tonight's agenda. Mr. Moriarty.
Sorry to interrupt, folks. I just received a text inquiring if tonight's meeting is live, as it frequently is. There appears not to be a live public feed. Thank you.
Wow, there go our ratings. So we'll give the clerk a second to anyone else while we're waiting for the... Everything seems fine on your end?
When I came in tonight, I was the first one, and I tried to turn the lights on and nothing came on. And then about 3 minutes later, the lights popped on.
The monitor's working.
Yeah, but so I don't know.
Yeah, that's because of those switches over there. It has to tell it it's okay.
So everything seems to be fine on our end?
That fixes everything, usually.
Okay, we'll move on. Interviews, we have none. Communications, we have none tonight. Public hearing, we do have a public hearing. And the public hearing tonight is on a resolution that is on page 80 of your packet. If you want to turn to... The actual resolution is on page 83. So this is a resolution that passed on first reading at our last meeting and is up tonight for a second reading under old business. And so I will hereby at this hour call to order a public hearing on resolution 2016-05, a resolution relative to authorizing the city manager to accept and expend grants on behalf of the city in the amount of $527 for Laconia Police Radar. Is there anyone who wishes to address the council tonight on this resolution? Apparently not. So I will declare that the public hearing is closed at 10 minutes past 7. And again, we'll take this matter up again under unfinished business. Presentations. We have a presentation tonight from the Wild Trail Committee. I believe Mr. Beadle is with us tonight.
Yeah, I was really hoping to be on TV, so if this isn't on
Malcolm,
TV...
Malcolm, yeah, this is going to be a big disappointment. I think you might have been a ratings killer anyway.
Thank you, Ed.
We'll see about that.
Thank you.
You got an extra.
You can have extras.
I'll find out. This is about a 45-minute presentation. Ed's asked me to do it in 20, so I'm going to be...
I'm sorry, thank you.
15, right?
15?
15, yeah.
Do I hear 15?
I give you five.
Can you pull down the screen?
Thank you, Alan. Good to see you, too.
Okay, first order of business is we're selling tickets for the WOW Sweepstakes Ball. They're $100. Gets you and a guest into the party and a chance to win $10,000, and that's good for everyone out here, too. Okay? So I'm here tonight. My name's Alan Beadle. I reside in Laconia. I'm currently serving as president of the WOW Trail. I'm happy to see our past president here, Diane Hanley. We're here tonight to ask the council to begin the process of approving Phase 2 of the WOW Trail. Now, let's just discuss time here. How much time do I have?
I'm sorry?
I'd like to know, do you want me to get it down under 20 minutes, or, I mean, I've heard...
If you can, 15 to 20.
15 to 20, okay. So we want to have a public hearing on this matter, so we're going to cover three specific items that we'll be asking you to consider. An administrative action for Scott to sign on behalf of Phase 2 construction, and then there's the matter that we've seen in the newspapers regarding the elimination of a right-hand turn lane and the elimination of 12 parking spots. But I'd like to cover some ground before we get there. I'd like to thank a lot of people, because we're at a point now where we've built one phase, we're about to perhaps build a second phase, and we've been doing this, how many years, Diane, 12? Five on Phase 2. And I want to take a moment to thank all of our board members, past and present, all of the volunteers, literally hundreds of volunteers, thousands of volunteer hours each year. There's a lot of civic organizations and community organizations that have make this happen, and the people in City Hall who make this happen, including the city manager, planning, Parks and Rec, police, and DPW in particular. We wouldn't be here tonight without the financial support of a lot of people. Literally thousands of our Laconia residents have contributed to this. Hundreds of businesses have contributed to this, and along with the TIF Advisory Board and your approval, a big chunk from the city in this phase. In addition, we have $100,000 from the CDFA, which is the first time the CDFA has ever given money to this kind of a project. All right, I'm going to get in trouble here now. So I'd like to say a couple things first about myself. This was suggested by my boss, and I first want to tell you that I'm a board member for the Belknap Economic Development Council, and I'm on the fundraising committee for the Colonial Theater, and the reason I tell you that is because I want you to know I'm interested in economic development, specifically in downtown Laconia. I'm not interested so much in theater, it's not really my thing, but I am interested in a vibrant downtown. And the other thing I want you to let you know about me is that I literally travel all over the place with my bicycles and my wife and my friends, and we go all over the place on these kinds of trails. And when we go, we spend lots of money. There's a picture of my wife in front of the Ross Castle in Killarney, Ireland, and there's a picture of this beautiful, look at that on the upper right that goes across a big inland waterway in Florida. I mean, the money they're spending in Florida. I could spend a lot of time on pictures here, but I'm not. But my point is that I do know something about these rail trails, and so some of the things I'm going to tell you tonight really do come from some of my experiences. And study after study will show, and I'm just going to, see, we like to eat and drink when we go, and that's the point of that one. All right, here we go. So I want to remind you that the mission of our organization, the WOW Trail, is to build a 10-mile trail from Belmont to Meredith. That's what our mission is. and we're trying to fulfill that, and this is an important meeting tonight. We've been given approval by the owner of the property, which is the state of New Hampshire, to use this land for this project. And I will tell you that this 10-mile trail will be a world-class amenity, bringing economic, recreation, and health benefits to this community for generations. Just not words, this is what happens when you build things like this. Study after study will show, and we did a study in 2012, and, you know, you can buy it or not buy it, but it says that 38,000 people from out of area will come each year to use this trail. And they'll spend around $2 million when they come each year on retail and shopping and staying over places, or they'll extend their stay. I think that's low, those estimates. We view this project as a key piece to the revitalization of downtown Laconia. Okay. So we have some experience to draw upon here. We built one phase. It only took 10 years, but we built it. So now we have some things to look at. In 2010, we opened up Phase 1 of the WOW Trail. Tremendous success, 40,000 people a year. We've done two studies, are using this trail. And we have all sorts of civic groups that are pitching in to make this a beautiful spot. Here's the Opeachy Garden Club that's made this entrance at Lakeport a beautiful spot. This is a great example of a public-private partnership where the Lake Opeachy Inn gave us parking for trail users. We gave them a beautiful granite stairway up to the trail for their customers. And that's what we have there. If you remember what that place used to look like not too long ago, it's come a long way. You know, there was big concerns when we built Phase 1. People standing here talking to you, citing safety, vandalism. You can't build this trail. Don't let it come through our neighborhood. These are actually the children of one of the women who spoke there. It was 6, 7 years ago. These are her children. They're out on the trail enjoying this down in the Moulton Street area. This is a more beautiful and a safer place to go since we put in this trail. And the PD will back us and has given us a letter regarding that. And you can see some of the amenities, murals, and so forth that has adorned this. So, you know, I show you this to remind you of the transformation of this corridor of Phase 1 before we get going in Phase 2. This is what it looked like behind Canton Chevrolet. And this is what it looks like today. And this is standing on North Main Street, the library to our right, the federal building to our left, and this is what it looks like today. So while we've cut some trees and got prepared for Phase 2, and it looks like hell out there, it looks horrible, you're going to see a beautification of the area when we put this phase through. So this is where it starts, right here on North Main Street, heading to Belmont. And we're going to connect to a 1.8-mile trail that Belmont is building today, and we'll have over 4 miles of rail trail. And now we're getting interesting. Now you're getting to the length where people from Plymouth or Concord, they might say, you know what, let's throw the cars let's throw the bikes in the car, and let's go up to Laconia, and let's do an 8-mile out and back. We're starting to get to a point where we're going to see economic benefits from this trail. You don't see that from Laconia to Lakeport. It's too short. Nobody's going to travel to do that. But at 4 miles, 4.5, you're going to start to see that. So there's a lot of interesting things that goes on with Phase 2 that I want to just share about. And one of them is getting people safely across a downtown area. We've got North Main Street, Pleasant Street you see here, Fair Street, all busy intersections. And look at what we have here. I mean, trying to figure out a better mousetrap here. And Scott was in charge, you can see. But no, this is our engineer from H.E. Bergeron, the Bureau of Rail, Department of Transportation, Public Works. You know, they're all here trying to figure out the best way through. So when we talk about what we came up with for design, it's not coming up with this lightly. The infamous shed, I could go on at length, but I'm going to just tell you that took 3.5 years to get around. And with the generosity of Denise Littlefield, the daughter of Lionel Labonte, who was the originator of Stratum Tire, During our work with this, Lionel passed, and Denise, his daughter, picked up the ball, and she's made a gift to the city to go around that historic building so we can continue on here. Looking from Water Street towards Bartlett Beach is the trestle. You can barely see, there's a trestle, and at the end is Fair Street. And without the help of, thank you very much, Rick Foster from the Citizen Building, we would have to get out and get out on the road. And it's never as good on the road. People love to be away from traffic on these trails. So we're going to skirt the back of that parking lot, and we're going to go up the side of the building, out to the sidewalk, over the Fair Street Bridge, and back into the railroad corridor, a very short distance, unlike Messer Street on Phase 1. So again, another abutter stepping up to help make this happen. So I wanted to show you this because this is kind of interesting. What we find as we go out and look at the Bureau's land, the state's land, is a lot of people forget where the property lines are. They just forget. And it's not necessarily intentional, but they just start using state land as their own, and then they think it's their own. And so while I was taking this picture, the person who lives in the house on the right came out, and he said, "Hey, you with the WOW Trail?" And I'm like, uh-oh. and I said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, how long do I have to clear this area?" I'm like, that's the attitude we're looking for. So I told him, with your approval, he'd need to have that cleared by July. Now also, it's hard to see, but there's a big steel beam holding up a roof there, and that also is in the state right away and also needs to go, and the state is working with that landowner to get rid of that. It's still standing. This was taken last Thursday. I now know what a vernal pool is, Diane, and a vernal pool is a part-time wetland, and there are critters that live in those little pools. And that's why, for the very first time, we're building a boardwalk. And so, in fact, it's a local builder who will be building that boardwalk and coming across it so those things can survive. But that's, again, another challenge we had of Phase 2. We have a bike shop on that building in the back there, and the guy can't wait for this trail to come down there. I wanted to point out, this is not a challenge area. This is a very easy area here, but this is probably one of the highlights of Phase 2. When we come through here with the trail, I think a lot of people are going to discover Bartlett Beach. It's kind of an underused amenity we have, a hidden gem. I mean, it's beautiful, but sometimes it's sketchy. There's not a lot of people there. People might not feel comfortable. But like Phase 1, when you start introducing lots of people regularly coming through there, people who are doing illegal behaviors go somewhere else. So I think we're going to see this park and this beach really flourish when the WOW Trail opens up. So here's the first two. We have Durkee Brook at the end of the beach area that we need to cross. So we're putting in our first bridge. It's a prefab bridge that'll come in. We'll assemble it on site. Some abutments need to be poured. And when we get across, kind of something like that, then we cut across the railroad tracks to the south side of the tracks. That's Mr. DuPont's house there. And the other interesting thing about this location is it's the first place the Bureau of Rail is allowing us to use split rail as a fence instead of a chain link fence. So we're really excited to get that out there and see what people think of that. Obviously, the Bureau's allowed that so that it will just look nicer out there, be more aesthetically pleasing. Okay, and this, now we're on the south side, and it takes us down to this area here. And unfortunately, all we're going to do here is fix the fencing as we tie into the sidewalk that goes up to the Belmont Town Line. Why aren't we fixing the sidewalk that's all bumpy and so forth? The answer is, we wanted to repave that and widen it. And the Bureau of Rail said, if you're going to do that, you're going to have to move that trail like 5 feet to the left, including the whole fence and the sidewalk, which then gets us into retaining walls on the left-hand side. So for now, the sidewalk will stay as is. Any questions about, that's pretty much phase two. I've got some more here. I'm going to show you what we've gone through for permits and approval. All these permits and approvals are in hand. And the only thing we need is approval from you and the planning board. We have since changed the final design that the planning board will need to review and go through that process. But we wanted to go to you first because there's significant street, the parking issue and elimination of the right-hand turn lane. But, you know, it's quite a bit of work to get that done. Funding, I said we get $100,000. We sold all of our tax credits, $125,000 worth to the local business community, netting us $100,000. We have $400,000 from your approval to let the city fund that with it being financed from the TIF account. We've raised, fundraised, got grants, fundraisers, donations, $588,000 since the last, this is going back now, probably 4 years on this. And then this year, we're good for at least $35,000. That's just rock solid $35,000. And what you'll see, we're going to need a little bit more. So that's 1.123 is what we've got for source of funds. Use of funds, we've already upgraded the Fair Street Bridge. As a matter of fact, I think it's 2010. Diane was thinking. She was thinking ahead. So that's been paid for, $160,000 in engineering, design, legal, surveying. That's all paid for. But we're really, really pleased that Lyman Construction was the low bid on this. Not only were they the low bid, but they were the most prepared bid, according to our engineer. And they feel really comfortable, our engineer, and Lyman feels very comfortable with the number we have here to get this project done. What we're not quite sure of is construction oversight, and we're estimating 25. It's right in the ballpark. I hope I can reduce that, but I'm not sure. And we put in a 10% contingency. The engineer was very comfortable to put in 5%, but we do have a couple of things, pole relocations and some landscaping that I felt more comfortable putting it to 10. So if you do the math there, we're short $76,000. Now, I want to let the city council know that shortage, I'm calling it an unfunded estimate of $76,000, will not prevent us from starting this summer and being substantially finished this fall if we have your approval. We have grants that are out, $60,000 worth of grants. We have other fundraising opportunities. There's no way that that will hold us up. Are there any questions on that?
I got a question.
I have a question for Councilor Balance.
I thought that the rail fencing that you were going to use down along Winnesquamish, you head out towards Belmont.
Yep.
I thought that the exception that they gave to DuPont for the rail was because he had two entrances and access, but the rest of the trail up to Belmont was going to be still chain linked. Am I wrong about that?
I believe you are. I believe we have approval all the way down to the end. Now, it started with DuPont property, and we didn't want to have, we've got a wood bridge, then we've got split rail, and we asked them to just carry the split rail to the DuPont Joyce property, excuse me.
Yeah, and they gave you permission to do that?
I believe they did. I could be wrong on that.
Well, I haven't checked this
Mrs. Gandini is nodding, yes.
That was just my recollection.
Yeah, I can have an answer back to you on that. I'm sorry, but I'm not sure.
Mrs. Gandini is nodding yes.
Yeah.
That's what, yeah, I was, yep.
Okay.
For the record, Mrs. Gandini is the executive director of the Wild Trail Committee.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? So if I could just make sure we all understand this, what you're saying is that at this very moment, you're $76,000 short of paying for the completion of phase two, but are entirely confident that that money will be in hand by the time the project is complete this fall.
Correct.
Thank you.
Okay, so there's three specific city council actions that need to take place for this to move forward. The first is authorization for Scott to execute documents, or the city manager to execute documents related to constructing Phase 2. So these would, these are probably most, but maybe not all, of what he would need to sign. There could be multiple change orders. Scott, are you aware of anything else besides these that come to mind? But they're, essentially, it's conducting business for this project and signing on behalf of the city for this project.
I think that's the bulk of it there. There could be something else, but I think that's the lion's share, yes.
The second item is elimination of a right-hand turn lane on New Salem Street. Now, New Salem really cuts and turns hard into North Main, and if you see where that wheelchair is, they're not even over to the sidewalk yet, but there's literally no room to put in a crosswalk there, which is kind of the obvious place for us to put this crosswalk. But there was no room. So we started looking, we looked way too many different possibilities here, and came back to this and said, this is the best place, this is the safest crossing, parallel to the railroad tracks. The Bureau requires us to be a certain distance away. So we said, well, let's look at the right-hand turn lane. And we did a traffic study on the right-hand turn lane. And that study was done, Gold, is it? Gold Consulting, I think they do work for the city. They concluded, and I have this in your packet, the overall effect will not be noticeable. They talked about a wait time on average of 3.4 seconds to 3.7 seconds for the driver. So people can still turn left and right. They just don't have a designated right-hand turn lane.
Have you provided the raw data for this survey?
I have it with me. I did not make copies for everyone. It's about 25 pages.
Well, I don't want to look at it. I just want to make sure that...
Yeah, I do have that.
Okay.
If you want to see it.
I just want to make sure we do some kind of internal review of that raw data. Have we done that?
It's been presented. I know staff has looked at that, and I think Mr. Beadle's correct that the overwhelming majority of traffic movement there is turning left. There's minimal in the right-hand turn. Still can occur, it just wouldn't be in the dedicated lane. So from staff's position, there's no concern from a traffic queuing issue if that right dedicated turn lane were to go away.
Okay. So you've actually internally reviewed the raw data?
I've reviewed it from a higher level, but some of our staff have reviewed it in much more detail, yes.
Okay.
Has anybody looked at the safety aspect of all of the pedestrians and bicycles coming across probably the second busiest street in the city?
The answer is yes.
Coming north and south.
We've looked at it in minutia and concluded that that is the best place to cross. In fact, one of the interesting things is now is you may, council, if you're down in that area, you'll see people are crossing there. They treat the railroad tracks as a crosswalk. Cars tend to slow a little bit, and pedestrians tend to use that. Well, we've got the WOW Trail there for one reason, but you have to go up further north to a crosswalk or down to the lights to another, and people... That wasn't you I saw this morning, Counselor, was it? Armin crossing right there? No, I'm just teasing you. we were together. I made him. So to answer your question, we think it's the safest spot, Brenda. Okay, here's the difficult one. Just another picture here. This is taken a couple winters ago, but just to show you, here's effectively the elimination of the right-hand turn lane in the winter with snow pushed to the right-hand turn lane, and that's all frozen, and that's been there. And I don't think the city
had... At that point in time, the right-hand turn lane was not plowed.
Correct. That's what I'm saying, yep. Effectively, you had no right-hand turn lane. Okay, so here's the difficult one. Elimination of 12 parking spots on New Salem Street. This stretch is from Pittman's Freight Room to the Pleasant Street. There's 12 parking spots there. We did everything we could. We actually have a design. that has a very narrow WOW trail, narrower parking, narrower lanes, and a shifted curb on the far side. And when it was all done, it was concluded it was not safe for the pedestrians and bicyclists coming down the trail. It was just too close, cars parking, doors opening, people getting hurt. We could not go with that design. It's just not feasible to squeeze everything in and do it safely there. And that forced the change to eliminate those spaces. Now, understanding the concerns of Pittman's Freight Room in particular and the downtown community in general, we looked for how to make up these 12 spaces. We worked with neighbors there who have property. We had an understanding to put in 25 parking spots actually across the street, but that fell apart. We met with other business owners and asked them if we could get some municipal parking, and to no avail. And it was certainly my plan to be able to come here with a backup for this 12 on-street parking. I understand how sensitive this issue is. Nevertheless, we don't have it. I do have some observations I'll share, and that is, first of all, during business hours, these 12 spots often look like this. I would say on average there's two or three cars there during business hours. We asked the largest employer, Bank of New Hampshire, do you have a problem with these 12 spots going away? And the answer was no, we don't have a problem with that. You know, so from a, what we're concerned about is Pittman's Freight Room and the loss of those spots, because when they're busy, those spots are full. So we looked at how do we find some solutions for these guys. The first thing that comes to mind is their own parking lot could be better designed for more cars. It's a grass field, and when I go back to park there for an event, it's park however you want, and it's not efficient. There could be more cars parked back there. Secondly, hi Chief, I don't know if this is a solution. I have not talked to the chief about this.
But I know what you're going to ask.
Yep.
Somebody else already did.
There's this. Well, maybe we could ask again. I don't know. But, you know, there's 19 spots to the left of the police department, close on the Pittman side. You know, I don't know whether there can be some arrangement that Pittman's could make use of that. Those 19 spots at the PD on Friday and Saturday nights, or and maybe that's the busy time, the PD, I don't know, but maybe, Chief, that's why you're here, to comment on that, I don't know.
No, I come to all the meetings.
Okay.
But I can comment.
So, yeah, let me finish up and you can jump in, okay? You know, also, so that's just an option that could be there. You know, I counted over 250 parking spots in neighboring businesses that are typically unused when Pittman's events are in progress. Over 250 spots within 150 yards or so of their front door. That's across the street here. It's at the plumbing business in Water, Culligan, I think. That's Stratum Tire, which will have a sidewalk right to their front door. 67 Water Street across the tracks. You know, there's parking out there. I don't know if there's the potential for Pittman's to make arrangements with any of those. I don't know that they've even talked with anyone other than the Salvation Army property. I don't know if they've talked, but I think there may be a possibility for them there. Now, lastly, Dr. Tom Finn, my dentist, is moving his practice to the corner of Pleasant and New Salem, that empty lot. And Tom, I have a letter in your packet from Tom that would agree to public parking during non-business hours. He doesn't want it to affect his business practice, but during evenings and weekends, he would allow public parking there. That would be, he said, 40 spots, but he doesn't have a plan done yet. So I'm thinking if we say 30 to 40 spots, we're going to be closer to make sure we're accurate on that. But that's not going to happen immediately. It's not going to be available immediately, but Tom knows our situation. I explained it to him, and he wants to help. So I'm just going to say some final thoughts on the matter. As I said earlier, we view this project, Phase 2 in particular, as a key piece of the revitalization of downtown Laconia. The WOW Trail will provide a safe and enjoyable way for people to get into Laconia without needing parking spaces. They can shop, they can get their bike service, they can eat, they can drink, they can experience the Riverwalk, they can maybe even go to the Colonial Theater without needing parking. The opportunity is now for us to proceed with Phase 2. We've been working on this phase for many years. We have the plan, we have the funding, we have the permits, we have the approvals. If this project is held up until a makeup of 12 parking spots is found, some of our funding may expire, other funding may be used elsewhere, and it could be many years before we start this phase. So the question is the community willing to give up the benefits of the WOW Trail that it will bring to downtown for 12 parking spots? I know we need to do something for Pittman's, and there are options out there. But I really hope that the downtown community sees this how I see it, which I really think is a revitalization, a piece of the revitalization effort of downtown. So we ask the council to schedule a public hearing so the community can weigh in on this matter. Thank you very much.
Any questions or comments for Mr. Beadle? Councilor Lippman?
I just clarify the procedural things that you're looking for here.
All right, I can clarify that, I think. Yeah. So they've asked for three actions, and those three actions are the abandonment of the right-hand turn lane, the abandonment of those 12 parking spaces between Pleasant Street and the first curve on New Salem Street there, and the authorization for the city manager to sign all the necessary documents. The idea would be to begin construction on or about July 1 and have the project completed and ready for public use by the end of October. And so what they're asking, and what I'd like us to do, is put this under new business tonight as item 7. And what we would be asked at that time would be to schedule a public hearing on May 9th on all of the above issues and any other issues that might come up relative to Phase 2 of the WOW Trail, with an eye toward taking a council vote on those three matters at our second meeting in May. So that's more or less the outline of the plan. Councilor Hamel.
Alan, you said that you're going back to the planning board with some changes. Could you
just... Yes, with the final draft.
What changes?
The only change, I think, will be these elimination of the 12 spots. The rest of it is the same.
Okay.
Yep. We didn't want to go that way, and then we wanted to come to you first on this.
And keeping in mind that the planning board approval of the plan was years ago now. I mean, it's taken that long to get all this done, so they haven't seen the latest engineering. And the primary difference is in that stretch of New Salem Street there. Councilor Lippman.
Alan, when would, if the construction went forward in the way that you described it would be, when would the parking actually be affected? And when would the right-hand turn
be? No, Jack, you want to weigh on this? Jack Lyman from Lyman Constructions here. I don't know that he's thought out exactly which end you're starting, or is there something you're...
Along with the elimination of those spots.
You come up to the mic.
Yeah, we need to identify who's speaking, and please.
My name is Jack Lyman.
Can you use the microphone, please?
We were the low bidder on the project. And along with the elimination of those spots, there is a coal plane operation that will be done on New Salem Street.
Is that resurfacing New Salem?
They're going to grind and resurface that street. Now, that would want to be done sooner than later. You wouldn't want to get into late October to do that, because you want to pave top, coat asphalt when it's warmer. So it would probably be more towards the beginning of the, or the middle of the project, August, early September.
So the parking would be affected as early as late August?
Yes.
And more likely early September is what you're saying?
Yes.
And the right-hand turn lane would be?
All that work would be done at one time. New curb, sidewalk, the brickwork along the other side of New Salem Street.
Yep. Great, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, any other questions or comments at this point in time, with an understanding that when we get to new business, item number 7, which we just added, that we will have a motion, we'll entertain a motion at that time to hold a public hearing on this matter at our May 9th meeting.
I'm just letting you know that I'm not going to be here on May 9th.
So noted. Councilor Bear.
I wonder why this couldn't go into committee.
I'm sorry?
I wonder why this can't go into a committee, Public Works probably. I think there's a lot of information that, I mean, it's all very general. We haven't really seen anything.
Well, I think that when the council
more
takes
more information you have,
the council
to
takes
the,
the matter up again on May 9th or on May 23rd. On May 23rd, a motion would be germane to do that at either one of those meetings.
Okay, it's just when the you have a public hearing, but they're not getting the input of what the council has found out or have questions to ask.
Well, I guess what we're doing doesn't mean we can't have a second public hearing.
Okay.
It means I think we want to hear from the public input on this as close to the front of this process as we can, and then go from there.
Brendan, we'll bring our engineer down for that meeting, so if there's specific issues that, you know, reading the plan or what have you, he'll be here for that. I didn't think we needed him for tonight, so I didn't.
Well, yeah, and also I would have liked to heard from the chief regarding the safety aspect of the elimination of that turn. I don't know if he wants to speak to it tonight or.
Well, we can, again, we can cover that. We're
moving along.
And everybody else. If there is anyone here tonight who can't wait until May 9th to address the council on this matter, there is a point in the agenda where we will take citizen requests to comment on current agenda items, and it would be germane for you to speak at that time if you can't. But the main public hearing on this issue would be held, assuming we pass this motion, would be on May 9th. So we don't drag this on forever tonight. Councilor Hamel?
When you come back for that public hearing, could you have a either schematic or a pictorial laid out of where it's going to look like, roughly?
Absolutely.
You know, behind the buildings.
I think they have the plans with them tonight, if you'd like to look at them. Yeah.
No, that's fine. Public hearing's fine.
They're pretty detailed. You know, it's hard to read, actually, I find it. Maybe we could come up with something that was...
Could it be just colored in to show the path?
Yeah, something that made it just easier for the general person right. to look at and kind of understand it.
As a public hearing, people may want to see how it's going to flow or go.
Yeah.
Or
I'll see what we can do on that.
Okay. Might make it easier.
Anyone else tonight? Okay, thank you. We appreciate it.
You missed him.
I'm sorry? What? What do you say?
Pat Wood wanted to say.
When we get to citizens' comments, we'll allow anyone else who wants to comment to comment on it. Okay. On to Mayor's report. First thing I want to mention there is that a couple of meetings ago, we had brought up the issue of developing a new city flag, and I had asked for a volunteer from the city council to head up that effort, and that call was not answered that night, but in the meantime it has been. And so my thank you goes out to Councilor Bounds, who has agreed to take the reins of this project. And so tonight, I am going to appoint the members of the, what he is calling the Flagship Enterprise Committee.
Bad name.
Okay, and their goal is to have a city, to have a contest of some sort and have the winner picked and back to city council for approval by the end of the year?
Yeah.
Is that the plan?
That's the initial plan. We haven't had the initial meeting. I'm open to whatever people want to do and what timeframes they can do it in.
Okay, so the initial membership of the committee to develop a new city flag to replace the current city flag, which is behind me here. I'm sorry, what was that?
What's wrong with the flag we have?
Counselor Bounce. Counselor Bear wants to be on the record as approving the current flag. And so the council will have the final say on this, Counselor.
Exactly.
Exactly, she says. Okay, so I appoint the following people to serve on the committee to develop a new city flag by the end of the year. Counselor Bounds, aforementioned, will be joined on the committee by Larry Freights, Carmen Gifford, Brianna Henderson, Ed Pierce, Pat Tierney, and Steve Tucker. Okay, and we look forward to that, Counselor, and thank you again for volunteering. And secondly, I just, on a personal note, wanted to add, I've got my annual baseball with me here tonight and want to congratulate the Laconia Little League for celebrating the opening of their, what was it, 66th? I think,
yes.
Was it? I think,
yes.
It was 66th season of Little League Base, 65, I'm sorry. I jumped ahead one. 65th year of Little League Baseball in Laconia on Saturday morning. And I was pleased to be joined at that ceremony at Colby Field by Counselor Hamill and by Chief Adams. And I also had the honor of being one of the people to throw out the ceremonial first ball. And I have an autographed baseball here, and I got four autographs this year. I not only have the autograph of the Little League catcher by the name of Colin Cormo, who had the unfortunate assignment of trying to catch my opening pitch, which meant he had to stay on his toes. But I also have the pleasure of having the autographs of the three other opening ball pitchers. We had four this year throwing simultaneously. And I'm not sure how fair it was to throw an old man like myself out there at exactly the same time as three members of the Laconia High School baseball team who were alumnus of the Laconia Little League program, but that's what they did. And so I got those three gentlemen to, they're 5-1, by the way, this year to date, and would recommend that everyone get out to Robbie Mills Field if they can to watch them play before the end of the season. But I have their autographs on this ball as well, and that is James Salta, Andrew Salta, and Griffin Nyan are the three gentlemen who joined me to throw out the opening pitch. So I appreciate them signing the ball, and we'll store this in the mayor's office and along with the others and congratulate them as well as Laconia Little League for the beginning of their 65th season here in Laconia. And that generation after generation is truly one of the ties that bind our community together as a throughout the country, as Councilor Hamill has recalled his own days not only playing Laconia Little League, not season one from what I'm told.
No, maybe two.
Maybe two. But also from coaching when his own son was that age as well. Okay, moving along. Committee reports. I don't believe we have any committee reports unless I'm misinformed this evening. How about liaison reports? Any liaison reports tonight from anybody?
You should down. Let me just give you a brief update. Because Ms. Saunders has left, that nickel's probably a good bet. But the economic chapter is in final draft form for
of the master plan.
Of the master plan. This is, I'm updating you on the master plan. I had it all put on my little sheet that I thought I was going to access.
We're asking you to pull the microphone closer to you, please.
With comments, but Scott, correct me if I'm wrong. The economic chapter and the land use chapter are full drafts?
I think they're both in full draft form at this time, yes.
Okay, and the remaining chapters have initial drafts that are sort of coming together as we speak?
Yes.
Okay, but because of staff shortages right now, I don't know how much progress is going to be made over the next month or month and a half, so I'm just letting you know.
Okay, thank you, Counselor. Next up, we have citizens' request to comment on current agenda items. Now would be the appropriate time on the agenda for anyone who wishes to address the council on any matter that is anywhere on tonight's agenda. Mr. Wood.
Mr. Mayor, Counselors, I'm Patrick Wood of Laconia. I'm on the Downtown TIF Advisory Committee, and at the request of the mayor, we met Tuesday at our regular meeting, and we discussed the WOW Trail requests. There was a unanimous vote to support the elimination of the right-hand turn lane on New Salem Street. As you know, we have previously also asked the City Council to be very cognizant of the need for parking in downtown, and if you're going to eliminate a parking space, we wanted something in its place. So there was no consensus on the second issue. I have reached out since then individually, and not on behalf of TIF, to the police chief, and we have had a conversation. There are about 20 spaces there, as Mr. Beadle indicated, and the police department is willing to talk about that and try to work to the extent they can, keeping in mind that they do need those spaces on a fairly regular basis, but are willing to be flexible in some discussion without making any commitment. Is that correct, Chief?
That sounds accurate.
All right. So that's where we are as far as the TIF committee. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Anyone else wish to address the council tonight on a matter that is on tonight's agenda? Yes, sir.
Sean McGuire. The only thing I wanted to address that was brought to my attention later today, that this 12 spaces were going to be eliminated. I frequent Pittman's Freight Room, and I am also a user of the WOW Trail, so I'm kind of in a tough spot here because I've obviously been to many WOW balls, and I support the WOW Trail. I just don't know if while you're thinking this toward May 9th, and you did address the possibility of some type of a compromise. Talking to Ms. Scandini, is it? They had looked at somehow, I don't know if there's a required size that this has to be, but I was kind of just addressing you now to think if there's any way to reduce that so you don't lose the car spaces, and how does it affect the entrance and exit of Pittman's, because it's fairly narrow there as it is. The handicap spaces, basically the people who need to get in, use the ramp to get into Pittman's. And again, there are so many different venues there. He does a lot of things that are great for the community as well. There are handicapped people that go to those things. And those spaces will be eliminated, I think. And I'm not sure on that, because you're taking away some of that entrance and exit. That's something I don't know. He said he's going to bring plans. I'd like to see that, and I think you guys should see it as well. It is the 50th anniversary of the ADA, and I think that's something to address. And for safety, going in and out of Pittman's, it's fine now. If you reduce it anymore, where does that leave you, you know, as far as exiting and entering? The 12 car spaces being another option. That being said, the WOW Trail is a great thing, so hopefully this can be some type of a compromise to make them both work, because I think Pittman's does bring culture and brings business to downtown, as does the WOW Trail and projections. Pittman's is doing it. The last thing we want to do is have a parking problem that we create. A parking problem because there's so much business and there's not enough parking is great. By taking away parking spaces, we're creating it. We already have a parking problem at certain times of the year. Pumpkin Fest, Coffee Fest. Keep all those things in mind, that's all.
I think I can add a little to what you said from from a meeting that I had last fall with Mr. Mitchell, the owner.
Yeah, that's, and I heard from him recently, too. I mean, I frequent the place.
But if you walk out the front door of Pittman's toward the railroad tracks.
Correct.
Where the pavement ends is the end of his property.
Correct.
Where the cars park now is state property.
State property, correct.
And the Wild Trail would go right through where those cars are parked now.
On
the state property.
And knowing that that's already a narrow spot, having that additional state property, as we have seen in some of the photos, has been used by anybody who created as theirs. Pittman's is no different. They've used that space, and I think to the benefit of Pittman's and to the benefit of the community that uses it, as well as, I mean, I have to say, Pittman's brings acts from all over the place, and they bring people from everywhere. This year, I went there for New Year's, and most of the people I talked to, they were from Massachusetts, Connecticut, Rhode Island. We get a lot of exposure for Laconia from a venue like that, and I just don't think we should, you know, snub our nose at that at the same time, giving Wild Trail some kind of access. And another thing I just wanted to ask, Mr. Beadle, your first photo, one of your first photos was of, I believe, the Riverwalk. Is there any way that we could have incorporated it into the Riverwalk and come this way over instead of going that way?
I don't see that.
Because we had to cross, we're going to have to cross the tracks over by the beach that you were talking about, correct?
Coming from North Main Street?
Yeah, I mean, because the only thing you'd have to do is you'd have to cross the tracks.
Mr. McGuire?
Yes. Oh, excuse me.
We're way off track here.
Yes, I'm sorry. I'm asking questions
having
to them because I don't have the answers. I don't know if you guys do. It's just something for you to think about. And that's all.
So your question was, we can keep this in mind for the next meeting, was,
right.
Would there be, if I'm understanding you correctly, your question is, would there be a way to eliminate that section of the Wild Trail and use the Riverwalk instead?
Connect to the Riverwalk, maybe, so that you could follow through there. I don't know, because one of the first pictures was of the Riverwalk, and it made me think, we've just spent a lot of money on that, and it's beautiful. Also follows the lake. It does go toward the end over there. Is there any way to connect those two?
Well, I think the plan is to connect those. The Riverwalk is planned to be an offshoot of, but the Riverwalk itself includes stairways, public streets, et cetera, et cetera. It's not as clear-cut one-way
path.
That
was just a question, so you answered some of it.
We just put in stairs, for example, on the south side of the river by the hotel.
Okay.
Okay, so yeah. There's a steep set of stairs there that are actually part of the Riverwalk that obviously you couldn't ride a bicycle down.
Right.
Or down.
See, that's something, that's why I was asking. Thank you.
Well, this raises a question that I don't know the answer to, and that is, assuming that the Wild Trail does go down New Salem Street in some fashion and the parking. Does it do anything in terms of the actual entrance and access to Pittman's in that back lot that they use?
No.
It doesn't?
No. There is a railroad right-of-way that runs through there.
Yeah.
That at one point in time, the owners of Pittman's had a right-of-way that they leased, I think, from the state.
Okay.
To get to their back lot.
To get to their
and
back
lot. Whether they have current permission to do that or not, I don't know. But there is a railroad spur that runs right toward the police station that dissects through there.
I'm familiar with that. I was just wondering if the Wild Trail was going to...
It's not a used spur, obviously.
Yeah.
But
if the Wild Trail was going to impact access to Pittman's back lot.
No, if anything would limit it, it would be that state right-of-way.
Okay.
Because of... Pittman building used to be railroad.
I'm sorry?
The Pittman building used to be used by the railroad company.
Yeah, it was a freight room, right?
That's right.
Hence the...
Good evening.
Ms. Vianar's Pond.
Ms.
Welcome.
Maureen Vianar. Yes, thank you. I think Sean said quite a bit of what I was going
Can
to
say. Can you get the microphone up close to you, please?
Sure. I think Sean said quite a bit of what I was going to say, but I do know that Dick has asked for... a lease
in front of the building, but it has been put aside for the WOW Trail. As far as the back area goes, I don't know, but I do know that the front, he did request, but was denied for the WOW Trail. And where that is, without those 12 spots, he figures there's about 40 spaces that he would lose where the WOW Trail would go in.
How many?
40.
Including the state right-of-way and the 12 spaces, which would total to 40?
No, without the 12. So without the 12, where the
40 already.
Excuse me?
40 without the...
40 without.
So 40 cars are now parking in the state right-of-way.
I guess that would be correct. So, Don Morin has let us park if we have an overflow. But that's only part of that parking area. The other parking area where the Salvation Army is, obviously there's a sign there that says no event parking. So we're not allowed, as far as I know, to park there at all. I obviously enjoy the WOW Trail. I have a mural on it, and you know, I'm certainly all for it. I also have a business at 108 Beacon Street West. There's difficulty in that parking lot. There's always people looking, and we give art classes. People have difficulty coming in, carrying their supplies. They've made several complaints of where else can they park. And I don't have an answer to that. I do tell them about the parking garage, but I'm not sure as to what the access of the parking garage is right now. And we do, the handicap is an issue. Where other businesses, it's the back door for freight room, it's their front door. So when you come in, I know it's not their property, as you say, but that's where our handicapped people have stopped. The ramps are there. And so what do we do with that? That's also an issue. We have musicians and people who come from as far as Australia to right through New England. They eat downtown. They stay downtown. So they do bring a lot of business into Laconia. And if anything, we need more parking than less. I guess that's about it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else tonight on this or any other matter that's on tonight's agenda? Ms. Henderson.
Hi. So in addition to owning a business downtown, I also live on Whipple Avenue, just half mile away from my business. So I walk the route on down Pleasant Street to Main Street every day, whether it's Monday, Sunday, doesn't matter. And I see those 12 spots all the time, not just when I happen to come downtown, not just, you know, once every few weeks. I see them every day, and they are used a lot. I would probably pick Monday being a lighter day, since there are many businesses downtown that are closed on Monday. But this is also a rare occasion where the two-hour parking limit is not enforced because of the parking garage situation. So those people that work downtown are parking in two-hour parking, and they're allowed to. So with a great many businesses opening up downtown right now, which is phenomenal, all good things, and I think the WOW Trail is a phenomenal, phenomenal thing, and I think it should go through, but you're opening up the can of worms that is the much larger issue, which is the parking downtown. With the exception of the parking spots that were added with the Congregational Church and TIFF working together, when was the last time the city added spots once they took them away? This is the kind of thing that we're looking at as downtown business owners, that especially in the transition right now with the Colonial Theater, we're going to deal with the Canal Street not having parking, possibility of the construction workers mobilizing in the municipal lot, plus the summer stuff that we have going on with the farmers markets, plus there might happen to be a funeral that day. Where is everyone going to park? Right now, thinking last year, those 12 spots were used by Bank of New Hampshire personnel while the two-hour parking was actually enforced, because those are all-day parking. And they're not the parking garage. You can still see your place of work. And sight, line of sight, has a lot to do with where people want to park, unfortunately. So if you're going to take them away, I would hope you would want to put them somewhere else. But ultimately, the parking garage, 12 spots, I don't care what it is, you have to find a way. And it's not just about Pittman's. They are in the downtown parking overlay. If you look at the zoning map, it's right there. It's the only overlay in the entire city. Those spots are needed for everyone. So, good luck.
Anyone else wish to speak tonight? Mr. Moriarty.
Good evening. I'm trying to think of what remarks might be germane for you to hear before the public hearing on the 9th. Before I start, I just want to conduct a moment of personal business. Alan, Mary and I would like two tickets to the wall ball, if you could make sure we're down for that list. So John Moriarty speaking now in the official capacity of the Laconia Main Street Initiative. And like the downtown TIF district, we were asked by the powers that be to take the temperature of downtown. And I take my homework assignments very seriously, and I would grade this one a solid B, maybe a B+. I've had roughly 100 hours of conversations with downtown business owners, operators, investors, and residents. And of those more than 70 conversations that I had, I can say not one single person came out to speak in opposition to the WOW Trail. Not one single person said that the WOW Trail should not be moved forward. Not one single person thought that City Council should vote to the contrary. Having said that, because there's always a but, the but to that is that I did lose track of some of the numbers a little bit, but in the conversations that I can document, of those 70, 68 said under no circumstances should anybody, City Council included, reduce the number of parking spaces within the downtown district. Again, of those 70, two businesses or individuals indicated that they would entertain a quid pro quo of these parking spaces for those parking spaces at some later date in order to move the WOW Trail forward on their time schedule, understanding the immediacy of the need for that decision. And again, no person, no individual said under no circumstance should these parking spaces be I think I got that wrong. Under no circumstance should the WOW Trail be forestalled for those parking spaces. So I think that's a pretty overwhelming response. And I find it encouraging that everyone that I've spoken with in downtown sees the benefit of the WOW Trail, not to downtown, not to the city of Laconia, but to the entire community of the Lakes region. And so I think they appreciate what Alan and the board, the WOW board, has done. But I think that there's pretty clear that things are not the same in downtown as they have been for the last 10 years. And I'd like to give you a few unscientific numbers. I've really wrestled with this, and I can't give you better data, but I'm still working on it. But when the downtown overlay parking district was created, there were some 1,100 parking spaces in the vicinity of downtown. Through various operations, the Rotary Riverside Park, a great project, some of the Green Islands and City Hall parking lot, the north extension of the Riverwalk, the Binney Media investment, we saw the need of one more business, and the Holy Grail moved to town, and we gave them two parking spaces for their dumpster. In total, the 1,100 parking spaces are now 18% fewer than they were when the parking overlay district was created, that number hovering now now somewhere around 900 parking spaces. And then if you add on top of that the reduction caused by the closure of the upper deck of the parking garage, according to my aerial map, 72 parking spaces, we're now at 825 parking spaces where we once saw 1,100. So I think one of the downtown business operators said it most eloquently when he said, 12 parking spaces is not going to break or make most of downtown, understanding the exception Pittman's Freight Room, but that we do need to look very, very seriously at how to restore those some 300 parking spaces that we are now without. And if you've had a chance to frequent downtown in the last several months, I think you will agree that parking is a different situation now than it was. So I look forward to working with the downtown community and the Wild Trail community. Perhaps we can have an open forum or discussion. I know I owe Gretchen Gandini several emails. I'm sorry, Gretchen. But if we can be instrumental in bringing everyone together, please consider us wanting to be part of the solution. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else tonight? Okay, we'll move on then to the manager's report and recognize Mr. Myers.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. A couple of items for your attention. One, I'm going to ad lib a bit based on a comment that was made at the podium. I just want to correct some misinformation. The city does, as resources allow, enforce the two-hour parking. It has not been a moratorium on that since the parking garage was closed for emergency repairs last fall. We did have a period where when the garage was closed unexpectedly that we didn't do it, but once the garage is reopened, again, as resources allow, we do enforce that. I believe the space spaces on New Salem Street that are in question are full-day parking spaces, but the ones a little more into the loop area, majority of those on the street are 2 hours, so I don't want people to get the impression that they should be parking there all day if they are signed for 2 hours. So the chief has also, as we announced last week, or earlier this week, I think it was last week, lifted the winter parking ban just in time for, I kidded him earlier, just in time for tonight's little slushy mix that we're going to get. So I know it's not going to amount to everything, but it was a good opportunity just to mention that to the chief with his timing on it. So it was all good there. So in your packet tonight, we have the project updates report. Again, this time of year being spring, we are in full swing with road projects. The water department's down doing some significant work on Holman Street. That'll be followed up by Public Works with a major paving project on Holman, Ashwood, Linwood. We're up there doing some paving on the Warren Street area. Pine Street up right now is getting some work. Some of the ball fields and parks are getting attention on various projects. Weir's Beach is also getting some attention, looking at the sand migration and working with DES on some items there. We're working with the engineers on some of the TAP grants, the Transportation Alternative Program grants, which are going to tie in with some of the infill sidewalk projects in the downtown and down along the middle school on Opeachy Street down to Messer Street. So those are more in the engineer and design phase. Excuse me. Second item that I've listed in your agenda packets and just wanted to brief you on is that we had recently received a letter from the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services notifying us that the city was being fined for an air quality issue in a fire training exercise that we did back in 2013. As you recall, the lodging at Christmas Island was slated to be torn down, and the property owner generously allowed us to do some controlled burning with some contents in there and have a realistic training exercise of that type of structure with contents. Our staff did reach out to a couple of agencies, and the verbal understanding we had received was that if we were not doing a full, complete demolition by the burn, it was kind of like, you know, you're all set to go. After the burning training exercise happened, we had received a call from someone at the state, and they just asked us to submit an application, not backdated, but after the fact, just to have on record that we had done the training exercise. That was the last thing we heard on anything until we got a letter about a month or 6 weeks ago indicating that there was a fine imposed on the city for not properly abating all materials that needed to be abated prior to the burn. And there were some asbestos tiles in there that were abated when the remainder of the building, and again, we only burnt a very small portion of it, was torn down. So a couple years after the fact, we were noticed of that. I followed up with the folks at DES, had good communication. As you see in the letter that's in the packet, they did reduce the amount of the fine, and further, they suspended an additional amount and assuming compliance. In my early conversation with them, I indicated that we had just created and or updated a policy in order to strengthen our contact procedure with the state anytime that we would do this type of burn in the future. They appreciated that we were proactive on that. There is, in my opinion, zero probability. I originally had asked for the entire fine to be waived, based on, our good intent, some outreach we had done. They looked at that and I think factored in some credit. They were not in a position where they were going to waive the entire fine, but we did get this amount here, and I just wanted to bring it to your attention just so that it was out there. But it was an unfortunate incident. It was nothing that was done intentionally. But really, it was a couple of years of when this letter came across my desk. I was surprised that this was the first contact, literally, since, I believe, August of 2013. So I'm informing you of that. Two other items, details to come, but kind of a hold the date. We're going to be holding a public forum down in the Weirs with a site and a time to be determined over the next day or two, but to do a public outreach, if you will, of the Lakeside Avenue project that we've talked about several times here. We have we've had some good numbers on what the paving portion, sidewalks, the drainage improvements, the water department is part of the project down there, and we've looked at some additional items of some streetscape. We did a small engineering study to determine if the four crosswalks were in the appropriate locations for safety, and if so, was there a way to make them more user-friendly with a couple of bump outs so that the distance that someone's crossing across four lanes of traffic down there is a little bit shorter and they've got a little bit of a landing area and a safe spot. So we've got some concepts there that we'll be reviewing. We've also had conversations just to look at the cost of what it would take to put all the utilities underground. Seeing this is a major reconstruction project, if there ever was going to be a conversation about putting utilities underground, now would be the time to do that, because we're not going to be doing another project of this size in the foreseeable future. So we have some numbers there. There were some questions that came up early on from some property owners. If we put the utilities underground, will it add more infrastructure, poles, transformers, and other areas of the Weirs? So in other words, by making the streetscape better in one area, were you going to worsen it? So we've got some information that we still will be formatting to roll out. We definitely will have packets of information available to people. We're hoping one full week before that meeting on May 12th so that people have a chance to review and understand. We'll do a presentation. By no means is this the only forum that we'll have. We'll base it on the response and questions. We'll have staff engineers on site to be able to answer questions we can that evening. There may be an opportunity to do another one a little later on in the season. Just basic timing of the project, regardless of whether we're going to go underground with utilities or not, is the intent would be to be starting the water work the day after Labor Day this fall and wrapping it up somewhere in the mid-November time frame when the construction season winds down, and back at it again in the spring of next year, spring of 17, to, as Mother Nature allows, to get back in there and do the remainder of the project in order to have it wrapped up for Memorial Day Motorcycle Week time frame. It may still be that we come back and do a final paving course later on in the fall, all that type of stuff, but that's a 30,000 foot view of what we'll be able to present that night.
Scott, if we do the underground, how would we pay for that? Would we have to make an adjustment to the budget before we pass it?
The money for the construction project.
Because it's not in the budget, right?
Not for the underground, no. And I've always said that wasn't going to be. I think the discussion all the way along was if this was going to be done, it would have to be used another source of funds and probably ideally the Weirs TIF account. And it's in its infancy. But this year in the budget book you just received a couple of weeks ago is one of the last pages. There's 28 or 29,000 flowing into that, and generally speaking, we see that area as having some investment being made, that number growing. So the part of the conversation with the TIF advisory board down in the Weirs and with the public would be knowing that yeah, I don't want to throw out too many numbers, but knowing that the 28 or 29,000 that's going in this year and that went in last year is not going to be enough to cover debt service on it, because this is going to be a big project. Could we arrange some kind of a due-to, due-from, where we're able to do the project in the timing, and then the Weir's TIF account repays the general fund a couple years down the road as that revenue stream increases? So we'll put out the numbers and have the options. The $1 million for the city's portion of the actual construction project, the drainage, the sidewalks, the streetscape, that is in your budget book and that is accounted for.
Right.
The water part, which is in the enterprise fund of the water department, is in their budget.
Yep.
So the basic, you know, do the proper reconstruction with the improvements is in there. It's the above amenities that would be subject to a different source to pay. So May 12th will be an evening meeting. We'll get the location out this week as well as the time, and we'll have packets of information available on the website and for people to pick up if they want a hard copy in your mailboxes, obviously, the week before that. The final item I want to bring to your attention, and this has been reported a couple of times, but with the busy corner intersection with CVS, I don't think it's any secret that CVS is working with the property owner of the old busy corner building to take that down. It's gone through the appropriate review steps. I think some of the preliminary work is starting late last week, and it's getting ready to come down. What I will be bringing to you in conjunction with CVS is they are going to actually donate that land to the city after the demolition has occurred and we get the legal documents in order. They're going to turn that parcel over to the city along with a sum of money in order to do some initial improvements to the site and just in landscaping, streetscape type of thing. So some of those dollar amounts to be determined. Their only request is anything that's planted there allows them visibility of the corner, which is the reason they're buying the building and taking it down. So whatever type of aesthetic landscaping we do in that area would be obviously hardy of nature, because you've got two main streets on either side with you know, the heat from the asphalt as well as the salt in the winter with that type of thing, but also of a an attractive height, but a lower height, so it's not growing up and blocking the view. They did it. So we're working with the folks at CVS in a legal agreement, but we'll be bringing that to you at the appropriate time over the next month or two for the city to receive that very generous donation on the part of CVS. So wanted to share that in case you heard some rumblings of that being in the works, and happy to take any questions or comments you may have on that or anything else.
Questions or comments for the manager? Nobody? Off easy tonight. Okay, we're on to new business. We have seven items now under new business, the first of which is on page 38 for a packet. And has to do with a request for the sale of tax-deeded property for less than the charges due the city. This is with regard to a lot on Sweetbriar Way in Southdown Place, Southdown Shore. You have the ID number there in your packet. There's $12,352.68 due in taxes on that property. And we have an offer of $6,000, or two offers made, I understand, one for $1,000, one for $6,000 on that piece of property. So we would need City Council approval tonight to sell that property for $6,000, which is half of the taxes that are owed on it. My understanding, it is not a buildable lot. Any questions about this before we get to making motions?
Just the valuation on the appraisal?
Mm-hmm.
It's at $40,000
what's on the
books.
That
seems like a pretty high amount for something that's not buildable. Help me understand that a little bit.
That was the current value placed on it. It has been determined that it's non-buildable. I'm not sure if it's just the size or if it's wetlands. It as it stands, that's not to say that if someone you know, were to purchase it, they could not benefit from the use of it and or privacy to that. Part of that is back taxes, and also included in that when we go out to a tax-deeded sale is the penalty amount, which is 15% of the assessed value, so that's a component of it as well. So I think we went out for four or five properties, and this was the only one where the bid came in underneath what was due on paper for it. So additionally, we are paying we are paying a condo fee every year on that by being in ownership in there, which is, we're not benefiting from being, I think it's listed in your $1,120 a year. Since we took ownership, and we're paying in condo fees. So it really is just draining money for no benefit to the city. So staff recommendation is that we sell this.
Councilor Doyle.
So out of the $12,352 that is the deeded sale amount, approximately $6,000 are fees that we've levied?
Well, the taxes on it, if we did the rough math, that roughly $22 right. per thousand just around us. So taxes on that, on the assessment, would be $880 a year. Obviously, we've had it for more than 3 years because we're at this point we're doing it. So say the tax component of it will probably be in the $2,500 to $3,000 range. State law allows you also to do a 15% premium penalty, if you will, on top of that. So again, based on the assessed value, penalty component of it would be $6,000, and then we would have whatever kind of legal filings and that type of stuff to it. So it might have been up to a fourth
so
year.
So the $6,000 would actually cover our actual costs?
Our out-of-pocket expense yeah. for not okay. collecting the property okay. taxes, yes, and whatever legal fees we've got.
This was the first year that it went up?
What's
the procedure for that?
We can take a property after we've done 3 years of leaning to it, and then we go through a process, and if someone is occupying, they have to vacate. I think this is the second year that we put it out to bid, and the first year I don't believe we got any
bids. It says
in
the memo that this was the first attempt of selling the property. Is that a mistake?
I'm going to if it says it in the memo, then I'm going to defer to the memo then, because okay.
That's from John.
Yeah.
John Gardner.
Any other comments or discussion? So Councilor Bolduc.
What would the person that wants to buy it do with it if he can't do anything with it?
The lot as it stands is not buildable. I'm not sure whether having this additional parcel next to it might allow them to do something more with their structure itself, or expand a little bit of lawn or something, possibly could hold a shed. Just because it's not buildable as it stands alone for a structure doesn't mean that somebody having a little bit of a buffer or a little bit of extra land for privacy wouldn't be a benefit to them.
So is an abutter that is got the high bid?
I don't know.
I guess I'm troubled with a $40,000 value, getting rid of it for $6,000.
Me too.
I'd like to know a little bit more about, you know, the disposition of it.
I can get you some details on who the high bidder was, and if you'd like to table this tonight, I can bring you back some specifics.
All right, so why don't we do this? Let's get the motion on the table, and then a motion to take to table would be appropriate at that point in time, all right?
Yeah.
Okay, so I would entertain a motion then to approve the sale of the tax deeded property located on Sweetbriar Way, tax map ID 250/272/12/009 for the price of $6,000, which is an amount less than the unpaid taxes, interest, fees, and charges for the property. Can I have that motion, please? For the record.
So moved.
Councilor Hamill, a second, please. Councilor Doyle seconds that motion. All right, the motion is up for discussion now, and a motion to table would be germane.
I'll move to table.
Motion to table by Councilor Lippman, seconded by Councilor Bolduc. Any discussion? All those in favor of tabling this motion, keeping it under unfinished business, please raise a hand. Six votes in the affirmative, that motion is tabled. That business is tabled. Thank you. Okay, next order of business, refer you to page 42 in your packet, is a request to approve the 2016-2017 Municipal Public Access Television Agreement between the City of Laconia and Lakes Region Public Access Television, and to authorize the city manager to sign the agreement on behalf of the city. You have the letter on page 43 indicating that our fee for the actually, the bill is on page 44, $25,877.50, which I believe is right at the ballpark of what we paid for the current fiscal year.
I think it was $26,000.
So this is basically a flat assessment to the city of Laconia to continue our agreement with Lakes Region Public Access and support thereof. Any discussion of that before we get to motions, questions, or anything? We have this money in the budget?
We do.
At this amount, okay. Okay, a motion be in order to approve the 2016-17 Municipal Public Access Agreement between the City of Laconia and Lakes Region Public Access Television, and to authorize the city manager to sign the agreement on behalf of the city. Councilor Hamel, would you like to make that motion?
I'll make that motion.
Councilor Hamel makes that motion. Councilor Bolduc seconds it. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. 6 votes in the affirmative, and that is approved. Next up, we're on to page 44. I'm sorry, it's not 44.
44.
48. Yes, this is having to do with the purchase of state-owned property located on the easterly side of Frank Bean Road. And this is an 1,813 square foot parcel. You have drawings of it on the following two pages on 49 and 50. Currently owned by the state, and they are willing to, this has to do with land that is in between two parcels, as I understand it, that are covered by the reclamation project having to do with the burn dump. It's a tiny little piece of land there that the state owns between land that we're reclaiming on the burn dump cleanup off Frank Bean Road. And they have, the state has offered to sell us that property for $400, their appraised value of it. And unfortunately, we also have to pay $1,100 administrative fee to pay $400 for the right to buy for the actual property for $400. So in total, it's going to cost us $1,500. So we're being asked to authorize that expenditure tonight. Any questions or comments before we get to making motions on this issue? Okay, motion be in order to authorize the city manager to confirm with New Hampshire Department of Transportation the city's interest in pursuing the purchase of state-owned property located on the easterly side of Frank Bean Road to allow the process to move forward, and to authorize the city manager to sign any and all documents related to that purchase. I have that motion, please. Councilor Doyle makes that motion. Is there a second? Councilor Bounds seconds that motion. Any discussion? All those in favor of this $1,500, please raise a hand. 6 votes in the affirmative, and that motion carries. Thank you. Next up, we're on to page 51 in your packet, and this is with regard to a request for funds from the non-capital reserve account for the replacement of the Tardic Park house floor at a cost of $12,000. And you have a copy on page 52 of the request from Shannon Allen of the president of the Tardif Park Clubhouse Association, detailing the problems with the floor now and the replacement floor they want to have replaced the current floor. And also, the city manager in your packet on page 53 has called attention for us to the fact that we are responsible for any structural repair to the interior roof floors, roof walls and flooring, etc. Mr. Dunleavy.
Good evening. Kevin Dunleavy, Director of Recreation and Facilities. So just a little quick some information about what's going on with the floor over there. It's a hardwood floor that's experiencing some buckling and has for a number of years now. We've looked at, and we've had contractors come in and look at it, and it's been determined that it's beyond a point where it can be refinished effectively due to how thin the boards are. The Park House is starting to see some, because due to this group that's come in, to see significant use through a lot of different events, a really engaged group over in the community, which is what we want to see these buildings used for. So they're really doing a great job, and I think part of this is, and they're also doing a lot of other work inside the building with painting and other improvements. They've bought new chairs with the funding they've been able to raise, new tables. And we've moved forward with getting some pricing for some tile floor, not replacing it with the hardwood, just due to the cost and also the type of maintenance that's it's minimized with a tile floor. The amount we're requesting is not to exceed $12,000. We've received three quotes, the lowest being $8,900, a second one that's in the neighborhood of $12,000, and then there's another one as high as $15,000 for replace it with tile. So we're requesting a not to exceed $12,000 with hopes that it can be done for a little less than that, but give us a little buffer if there's some unknowns. The structure itself, the supporting structure for the floor is in good condition. The Parks and Recreation maintenance staff installed a moisture barrier in the crawl space under this main floor, just to help alleviate any future problems with moisture that's developed. There was never a moisture barrier under there, so we've done some things to try to protect any future investment in the floor as well.
Any questions or comments? Questions for Mr. Dunleavy? Any other discussion before we get to making motions? Councilor Hamel?
That's a wood floor there now, right?
Yeah, hardwood floor, yeah.
They're going to put an overlay over that?
What we're going to do, they're going to rip out the wood floor, put in a new subfloor, and then tile floor on that.
Anything else? Thank you.
Great, thank you.
Okay, a motion will be in order to approve funding in the amount not to exceed $12,000 from the non-capital reserve account for the replacement of the floor at the Tardif Park House.
Say that three times fast.
I'm sorry?
Say that three times fast.
Yeah. Absolutely. Councilor Bullock makes that motion. Is there a second? Councilor Hamel seconds that motion. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. Six votes in the affirmative. That motion carries. We're on to item five. This is a request from the Belknap Mill Society to fundraise at Rotary Park on Friday, July 8th of this year from 5 until 9 p.m. and to serve alcohol in a city park. And this request is on page 62 of your packet. And this has to do, you'll note from the application, for the fundraising event known as the Summer Soiree. And I believe alcohol was served in the mill itself last year, but people were migrating outside. And so what they're asking, this is why it's under new business as opposed to consent and action, because this is a new request to have this, the actual sale and consumption of alcohol outdoors in Rotary Park. Questions for the staff?
So they're not going to sell it inside and let them bring it out. They're going to sell it outside? Is that the idea?
I'm not sure the exact setup, but it was a nice night in July, and I think with the music and the nice, cool temperatures, I think people were migrating outside. So I think the intent, obviously, is to take advantage of that on a Friday night in July. So there'll be anything they do up, they'll have it, you know, properly located and controlled, but it would allow them to have it outside as well as if folks wanted to go on the inside of it as well.
Is that part of the weekly music?
No, this is a summer fundraising thing. It's the summer soiree.
The concerts are free.
It's not part of that.
It's not the weekly concerts. This is a one-time event fundraiser.
Okay, I thought it was part of the weekly thing.
No.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Doyle.
I know that whenever you use any of the facilities, the Parks and Rec facilities, you have to post the $1 million level of liability insurance. Mm-hmm. Is it going to be a higher level because alcohol is served, or will it still be at $1 million?
I think the $1 million is the base of what we're doing, and I think when you look at the letter that the that came from the Parks Commission on page 66, they indicate that it shall be there. That they were referring this to the council for the fundraising component of it.
They still have to get permission from the licensing board.
Right, the licensing board will have to take up the actual alcohol approval. But we certainly wanted to bring it to your attention that the intent was alcohol as in conjunction with the fundraising, and it was going to be using a portion of the park.
Anything else before we get to motions?
Have they gone through the permitting committee there? Which one I mean?
It's not a special events type of thing. It's basically, it's a controlled environment, and it's nothing out of the normal procedure, but they'll go through the licensing board just for the permission to sell the alcohol.
Okay.
But they wanted to come through. They came through the Parks Commission, came to the council for the fundraising with the acknowledgement that this is what they're looking to do, and then their final stop will be the licensing.
Okay, a motion would work. Excuse me. Get to the right page here. A motion would be in order to approve the request from the Belknap Mill Society to fundraise at Rotary Park on Friday, July 18th, 2016.
8th.
From 5.
8th, not 18.
Sorry?
July 8th.
Yes, I'm saying aloud 16.
Oh.
Right. Did I say 18? Oh, I'm sorry. Let me start over. A motion would be in order to move to approve the request from the Belknap Mill Society to fundraise at Rotary Park on Friday, July 8, 2016, from 5 until 9 p.m. and to serve alcohol in the park as requested. Someone make that motion, Councilor Bounds. Is there a second? Councilor Hamel seconds that motion. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. We have 6 votes in the affirmative, and that motion carries. Okay, we're on to item 6. That is on page 67 of your packet. We have 2 requests tonight. This has to do with the Winnipesaukee Muskrats baseball team use of Robbie Mills Field and Robbie Mills Park. And the first thing that's being asked tonight is for us to approve the amended facility use agreement between the city and the Muskrats and to authorize the city manager to sign the agreement on behalf of the city. If you'll recall our last discussion on this matter, there was a question that the written agreement lease with the city, which had been revised a year ago, had not been since revised to account for the fact that the Parks and Rec Commission had agreed to extend the time period for dealing with the structure behind the Little Green Monster in left field, which was to be dealt with by November 1st of last year, has now been extended to November 1st of this year. So that contract would be updated to reflect that and would be signed by so we would be authorizing the city manager to sign that revised agreement. Everybody understand that? So that one's pretty easy, so why don't we take care of that first? Do we have any questions on this issue before we get to the second one?
Just for acknowledgments, Christian is here, who is the manager of the Muskrats tonight.
Yes, and he can answer any questions if we have any. Councilor Bear?
Well, I want to ask the city manager. I came across a lease with the state for the city to use Risley for parking,
mm-hmm.
but it only ran 2.5 years. Is there a record? Do you have an extension of that lease? Because one of the requirements in it is that it is untransferable.
The use of the parking lease would stay with the city, and I think the original date you referred to was maybe in conjunction with the state, maybe thinking the property was going to be sold by that point. So we can double check where we are, but the lease for the parking would remain with the city.
It ran out in 12.
There was an extension. Parks and Recs, I think.
We'll double check it, yeah. But I think the state would be negotiating with the city for that. I don't think we would lose the right to be the one to enter into that, but we'll double check that.
Any questions or comments about the the lease itself before we get to that motion, then we'll get to the other item next. Okay, a motion to be in order to approve the amended facility use agreement between the city and the Winnipesaukee Muskrats, and to authorize the city manager to sign the agreement on behalf of the city. Mr. Hamel, would you like to make that motion? Motion from Mr. Hamel, seconded by Counselor Bolduc. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. We have 6 votes in the affirmative, and that motion carries. Okay, the second item has to do with the sale of alcohol at the Robbie Mills Sports Complex by the Muskrats organization during the upcoming season, as approved by the Parks and Recreation. And I would call on Mr. Dunleavy, if he could, to brief us on exactly. This has been approved by the Parks and Rec Commission. And one change I would note in your packet tonight on page 67, under motion number 2, it says, I move to acknowledge, and we need to change that word acknowledge to approve. That was a mistake in the agenda. So we haven't got to that point yet, but if you would change that word acknowledge to approve. Mr. Dunleavy.
Yes. The Muskrats had come before the Parks and Recreation Commission with a proposal to serve alcohol at Robbie Mills Field. And this would be is intended to be a temporary arrangement with intentions of moving this operation to the observation deck, much like the original proposal that the Muskrats brought before the city, going back 2 or 3 years ago, which never happened due to the construction of the observation deck not happening. The Muskrats had proposed an area in the parking lot along the third base line, outside of the driveway area, an area that sits behind the third base bleachers, to install a tent and enclose an area for the consumption of alcohol. They've asked they'd be using a local vendor and their liquor license for this operation. Chris can talk about specific details about, you know, how it can be controlled, but it would be enclosed with a fencing or a crowd control barrier so that, you know, it would be a controlled environment there. The Parks and Recreation Commission has approved this use for 1 year and with the conditions that it also received council approval and licensing board approval. The licensing board did hear the Muskrats came before the licensing board at the beginning of April and received approval for it through the licensing board. So this would ultimately be the last step for the approvals that they're seeking.
Okay, Mr. Svenland, would you like to provide us with the specific details?
Absolutely. First, Christian Svenland on behalf of the Winnipesaukee Muskrats, and I have a mock-up of the area.
I was looking at the map. Right now, there are, Mr. Dunleavy, there are bleachers right now in that area, right?
Actually, this area will sit behind the bleachers.
Well, but there's, okay, there's 2 sets of bleachers out there right
Correct.
Now.
That one's mine.
The recessed bleachers, and then there's another set of bleachers that are actually sitting
on the
park.
Those will move.
So those are going away.
Yeah, we move those back and forth depending on, we move them over the soccer field during the soccer season, so those can be moved easily.
Okay.
So as you can see on the map, the plan is for a 20 by 30 tent that is in red or fuchsia. And then from there, if you, the jotted line down, another 20, 30 feet, then an in-cut to kind of keep the traffic able to flow by easier, and then some, you know, the other apportion line there, and then the exit would be at the end of that towards home plate or the current concessions. The entrance would be, you know, past the tent. It would be a manned entrance, obviously, to check for ID. So the request is to have availability for beer and wine sales at our events over the summer, between starting June 10th is our first home game through August 13th, or, you know, our championship game.
And you have a concessioner that's going to run this?
Our concessioner is going to be the 405 Restaurant and Pub, and it's going to be off of their liquor license.
And they'll be serving food there as well?
They will be serving food there as well. There will be a grill that is right next to the tent, so that anybody walking in will be able to purchase a grilled item without having to enter the alcohol area. And the beer sales will be further inside the tent, so there won't be any beer sales outside of that tented area. The beer sales will be inside the tented area.
And the concessionaire will be in charge of restricting entry?
Correct.
Any questions for Mr. Svenlund while he's up here? I guess not.
Let's give it a try.
Thank you. Okay, any questions or comments before we get to making motions here?
I'd just like one clarification, Mr. Mayor, if I could. So, as we just mentioned with the Belknap Mill Society, it's the licensing board that approves the alcohol license. But in this particular case, it came as a condition from the Parks Commission, and they asked for City Council approval. So, just acknowledging in your motion that you're approving the fundraising, which in this case does include the service or sale of alcohol. I just want to make it clear for the record that, again, Council typically does not approve the sale or use of alcohol in a city facility, but in this particular case, it was made as a condition by the Parks Commission that they wanted that extra layer of review, so to speak. So that's why
this has to do with that ongoing conversation we're having with the Parks and Rec Commission itself in terms
of. So it's just everybody having checks and balances, but I just want that for the record that it's not typically your role, but in this case, it was referred to you because the Parks Commission wanted to make sure everybody was on the same page with it.
So would the motion now read, I move to acknowledge the request for approval?
So we're changing the word acknowledge to approve.
So maybe it would be to approve the fundraising, which includes the serving of alcohol, I think would be a way to have the motion for the record acknowledge that the request was for alcohol tying into the fundraising, which is definitely under the council's purview.
So let me say it for the benefit of the clerk out loud.
Hear me out. Okay. And move to acknowledge the request for approval from Parks and Recs. With respect to the service of alcohol, doesn't that cover it?
No, we're not acknowledging their request. We're approving it. They told the Muskrats that we needed to approve it also.
Well, I suppose the wording is not that important. So go ahead.
Okay, so the motion would be in order to approve fundraising, including the serving of alcohol at the Robbie Mills Sports Complex by the Winnipesaukee Muskrats organization for the upcoming season, as approved by the Parks and Recreation Commission. Have a motion to that effect. Councilor Bullock, is there a second? Councilor Lippman. Any discussion? Councilor Bear.
What is the fundraising element?
They're selling products on city property. That's considered fundraising for purposes of administrative oversight.
Not necessary, Chair.
It's for the operation of.
Well, if you're selling popcorn at.
Which has been in a
Opeachy
deficit
Park.
Ever since.
I know. I don't want beer.
Councilor Lippman.
Just more for curiosity, in terms of the. Like at. When you're at other ball games, there's a time limit where they stop selling and a limit on the number. Could you address that?
Yeah, the idea is to offer the alcohol sales prior to the game starting, up until 8:30 or the middle of the eighth inning, whichever comes first.
And is there a limit?
6:30 start, is that?
The games will be starting at 6:05 this year. The limit would be four beverages per person.
Thank you. Any other questions, or not questions, I'm sorry, any other discussion at this point? We have a motion on the floor. Okay, we'll get to the vote then. All those in favor of approving the motion, please raise a hand. All those opposed? We have 5 votes in the affirmative, 1 in the negative. The motion carries. Thank you. Item number seven has to do with the WOW Trail, and the appropriate motion would be to schedule a public hearing to be included on the city council agenda on May 9th during the regular city council meeting for all to hear from the public on all matters concerning Phase Two of the WOW Trail development. On a motion to that effect, Counselor Bolduc, I mean, sorry, Counselor Hamel, is there a second to that motion? Counselor Doyle, any discussion? All's in favor, please raise a hand. Six votes in the affirmative, that motion carries. So that will be on the agenda on the 9th of May. Unfinished business.
Mr. Mayor, if I could?
Sorry, yes.
And I'm recommending we use the same specific language that we used here, and speak specifically to the discontinuance of the parking spaces in the right-hand turn when we advertise it, just for erring on the side of public knowledge with that.
Okay, yes.
Okay.
So who made the motion? Counselor Hamel did, and the second was from Counselor Doyle. Do either of you object to that?
Nope.
Specifying that language?
That's
in tonight's agenda. Does the clerk have that? You're specifying the motion that passed, Mr. Hamel's motion, seconded by Mrs. Doyle, that language include the specifics that are in tonight's agenda.
So what I have is that it will include the construction phase two of the WOW Trail and the elimination of dedicated right turn lane on New Salem Street and 12 parking spaces on New Salem Street in the area of Pittman's Freight Room.
Yes, I just want to make sure that the motion includes the language that I used, meaning that any issue regarding phase two would be germane, not just limited to those specifics, but including those specifics. Counselor Lubin.
So just in terms of how we structure the hearing, it seemed like, you know, Counselor Bear made the point earlier about there being sort of an further informational component before we start the hearing. I don't know that we have to design it right now, but in terms of, as opposed to just taking public comment on something that people might not fully appreciate, maybe have a on those particular items, I think those are an offer to present some plans and just walk people through what the changes are before we start the hearing.
Prior to the hearing, you mean?
Or as a part of the hearing, the opening of the hearing.
Yeah. Okay. Probably their engineer or architect could go through the plan.
We could ask the WOW Trail, Mr. Beadle, to make a very consolidated presentation on just that aspect of it that night at the beginning of the hearing.
Yeah, or perhaps we schedule...
Can you come up to the microphone, please?
Yes.
Perhaps...
What's the meeting start at 7? Public
yes.
hearing? So perhaps at 6, we have the engineer available in...
Well, we have a budget meeting.
We have a budget meeting starting at 6 o'clock that night.
But I mean for the public to get in and look at the details and have all the plans laid out, so anyone could come and get into that earlier, perhaps.
Well, what we could do if we advertise it, perhaps, is we could have the plans spread out in the conference room.
While we're having
a hearing in here, the plans could be spread out on the large table next door in the conference room, and we could advertise it that people could view them before the start of the public hearing there.
Yeah.
We can work with you on that.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, one item of unfinished business, refer you to page 80 in your packet.
Don't we need to approve?
Can we not vote?
No.
Not for the second time, not for the amended motion.
Sidetracked here. All right, we have a motion on the floor.
You're on it.
Made by Counselor Hamel, seconded by Counselor Doyle. All those in favor, please raise a hand. We have six votes in the affirmative, that motion carries. Now we're on to unfinished business. Page 80. As you know, Laconia Police Department has applied for a highway safety grant in the amount of $527. That's the item we have before us tonight, and the actual resolution. There's a memorandum from the police department on page 82 that explains it. The actual resolution is on the following page, page 83. Before we get to this, I would entertain a motion to waive the reading of the resolution in its entirety and to read by title only.
So moved.
Moved by Counselor Hamel, seconded by Counselor Bolduc. Any discussion? All those in favor of reading the, waiving the reading of the entire ordinance, please raise a hand. With five votes in the affirmative. And Counselor Bounds is temporarily out of the room. So there were five affirmative votes on that motion. Okay, any discussion or questions about this item before we get to making the motion itself? None? Okay, motion be in order to approve resolution on second reading, resolution 2016-05. A resolution relative to authorizing the city manager to accept and expend grants on behalf of the city in the amount of $527 for Laconia Police Radar. So I'm gonna make that, Counselor Bolduc makes that motion, a second by Counselor Bear. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand.
Since I don't know what I'm voting for, I'm not gonna vote.
We're voting for resolution 2016-05, which is on page 83 of your packet. To do with the grant for $527 for police radar.
I'm in favor.
All right, let's try again. All those in favor, please raise a hand. We have six votes in the affirmative, and that resolution is adopted. Thank you. Nominations, appointments, and elections. We have two tonight. The appointment of Peter Stewart. That's on page 84 of your packet. He is the first to apply for a position on the Lakeport TIF Advisory Committee. I don't think any discussion is necessary there. A motion be in order to appoint Peter Stewart to a regular position on the Lakeport TIF District Advisory Board for a three-year term expiring at the end of June 2019. Counselor Bolduc would like to make that motion, seconded by Counselor Bear. Any discussion? All those in favor of appointing Mr. Stewart, please raise a hand. We have six votes in the affirmative, and that motion carries. Next up, we have the appointment of Brandy Laughlin, Assistant Planning Director for the City of Laconia, to the Lakes Region Planning Commission Transportation Advisory Committee for a three-year term expiring March 2019. This is made necessary by the resignation of Mrs. Saunders. So we need to appoint her replacement to serve on that committee on behalf of the city. Can I have that motion, please?
So moved.
Councilor Hamel, seconded by Councilor Bounds. All is in favor of appointing Brandy Laughlin, our Assistant Planning Director, to a three-year term on the Lakes Region Planning Commission Transportation Advisory Board, please raise a hand. Six votes in the affirmative. That motion is also adopted. Council comments. Councilor Hamel.
Yes, I just want to pass around something real quick. We brought up before about the problem that they've had on Lindsay Court with the dumping of material that wasn't supposed to be there. And
where?
Lindsay Court at the remote dump site. You can pass that to him.
Yeah, sure. You know, the tennis court's out at Memorial.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Okay. So Public Works put up a camera, which is actually a, I don't know what you call it, it's an animal camera. It costs like $99, and they put it up, and there's a sign there that talks about the illegal dumping. And before this, they were taking truckloads of things out of there that weren't supposed to be there, couches, you name it. And since that's been put up, nothing. Nothing has been left.
And the camera's still in one piece.
The camera, yep. The fire department helped make the framing of it. And like I said, since that's been there, they've had no more problems. They've had one guy that went up and put his hand in front of it, but they do have his picture before he got there.
Is it a crime to put your hand in front of it?
Yeah, and I guess the pictures are crystal clear, you know. And I would like to suggest the council do the same at the other two sites. The one in Lakeport and the one in the Weirs. It's very inexpensive, and I think there's probably could be monies in the Public Works budget to do that, maybe.
We can find something if the council would like. There's also a remote location on Messer Street.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. Right. So, for the camera and a fence post, it's taking care of the problem down there, so.
So how do we want to handle that? Put it on the agenda next time? Is it necessary to do that, or?
No, we've got the money within the budget for a small amount. If that's directed, we can make that happen.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion that that gets directed.
We have a motion by Councilor Hamel to have the city manager supervise putting remote cameras at the.
I'd like to have seen him do it.
At the Messer Street and Lakeport Fire Station remote.
Weers.
And Weers.
I'm sorry?
And the Weers.
So you want three more. Mm-hmm. And Weers Beach. Those three sites.
Thank you.
Is there a second to that? Councilor Bolduc seconds that motion. Any further discussion?
Yes.
Councilor
Bolduc. In Lakeport or even at the Public Works Garage, can that be put on the building rather than a post? So that the people
put it on a corner of the building?
Well, it's got to be aimed somehow.
Yeah, well, the back of the fire station's right there, and so is Public Works.
Yeah, I'm sure they could come up with something.
Building there.
We can look to see if we can get them on a building rather than on a post.
I don't know. It has to be tripped.
They're motion sensor type of thing, and then
correct,
at nighttime,
I don't
light
know
flashes,
how,
and they do a camera
I don't know
type
how
of thing.
Far
so
away.
I think it all depends where the beam is angled type of
correct.
Thing. So
that's something you
we'll,
could come
we'll
up
figure
with.
The logistics out, and if we can do it, we will.
Okay. Any further discussion?
Thank you.
All those in favor, please raise a hand. 6 votes in the affirmative. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Any other council comments tonight?
Yeah.
Councilor Bounds.
Okay, so I was crazy enough to try to organize this flag committee to come up with a new Laconia flag. And we haven't had our first meeting yet. I'm going to try to set that up for next Tuesday. But I just want you to be aware that I think we're going to need some kind of seed money for a website or something like that. I don't know what the costs are going to be, but they should be minimal. I'm just making you aware. I'm not asking for any.
Can't they use the website of the city?
So you'll be coming.
No, we have to. I think we have to. We can use the website of the city, but I think we have to design something that will take designs for a flag or some way to submit them, huh?
To upload, to accept
yeah,
uploads?
To upload and
your, that. It would work on your computer.
No, I think I'll use yours, Bob.
Can
as long as you're volunteering.
Anyone else? Okay, we have need for a non-public session tonight. A motion would be in order. I do not expect any public action after the conclusion of the non-public session. And I would request a motion to go into non-public session according to RSA 91A:3:2 for the consideration of the acquisition, sale, or lease of real or personal property, which, if discussed in public, would likely benefit a party or parties whose interests are adverse to those of the general community. I have that motion, please.
So moved.
Moved by Councilor Bounds. Is there a second? Councilor Bear wants to second the motion. So we'll have Councilor Bear second that motion. Would ask that the clerk please call the roll.
Councilor Doyle.
Yes.
Councilor Bounds.
Here.
No, that's not.
Say yes.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Lippman?
Yes.
Councilor Bear?
Yes.
Councilor
Hummel?
Yes.
Councilor Bobbitt? Yes. You're giving me a hard time.
Motion carries on a most enthusiastic vote.
Yes,
Councilor Bounds noted that most enthusiastic vote, and we are in non-public session.